life
more abundant with me. Always abounding and filled with my goodness, life overflowing, you'll see. I came so you can have life more abundant.
Life
more abundant with me. Always abounding and filled with my goodness,
life
overflowing, you'll see.
The Spirit of the Lord is flowing through me, proclaiming the good news to all in need.
Welcome to ZChurch. Pastor is teaching today. Mountain, are you listening to me? Be sure to take notes. Grab your elements. We will be having communion and you don't want to miss out. If you have a prayer request, get that in. We will pray for you today and stick around for the afterglow following the service on the Zoom platform. Anna, will you pray for us today?
Thank you, Christian. Father, thank you for your love that is perfect, for your grace that is amazing, knowing that you delight to give us everything. We pray that this gathering will be filled with anointing in the word that our pastors will share. Your truth will bring deliverance, healing, and boldness in every person who watches this broadcast, and that they may be touched as only you can touch them, Lord. Joseph, please lead us in worship.
Thank you, Anna. All right. Today's victory chant, I got my dad with me. Hallelujah, let's go. Hail Jesus, you're my king.
Hail Jesus, you're my king.
Your life frees me to sing.
Your life frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my days.
I will praise you all my days.
You're perfect in all your ways.
Perfect in all your ways.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I will obey your word.
I want to see your kingdom come.
I want to see your kingdom come.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Not my will, come on. But yours
hey.
Be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You will take us into the land.
You will take us into the land.
We will conquer in your name. Jesus reigns.
Come on.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
Said, hail, hail, line of Judah.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
Hail, Jesus, you're my king.
Hail, Jesus, you're my king.
Your life frees me to sing.
Your life frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my days.
I will praise you all my days.
You're perfect in all your ways.
Perfect in all your ways.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You will take us into the land.
You will take us into the land.
We will conquer in your name.
Jesus reigns.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
Said, hail. The tribe of Judah, the root of the offspring of David, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. Do not weep, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of the David, has prevailed to open the scroll and loose its seven seals. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
And hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
The Lion of Judah shall break every chain and give to us the victory again and again. The Lion of Judah shall break every chain and give to us the victory. Come on! Again and again. Come on. Hey. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
And hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
Welcome to ZChurch. I'm Pastor Larry, and you are at the best online church in the whole world. Z Team, you did amazing today. Pastor Loretta's off camera, but she's here. Pastor Loretta, say hello.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to ZChurch. And Pastor Larry, I might be stealing your thunder, but I have to tell you that ZChurch, our Z Team family, we gathered around Joseph and prayed for his father. And look in the background there, we see Joseph's dad. And we are just praising God for that miracle. Yeah. Praise God. So that was exciting. Praise God. And I just want to say, if you have a prayer request, you have time to send it in. Terry, where do we send it?
You can put it in the chat or send it to info@zchurch.life.
Amen. And we'll be praying after the communion. And you can have a miracle just like Joseph and his father. Well, Pastor, I'm looking forward to the message. You have a message about voice control. We can have what we say. Is that right, sir?
Yeah, that's right. And I'm excited about it, too. We're going to have a great time in the Lord today. We want to welcome Brenda. Brenda, thanks for joining us today. You're very welcome. And everyone
and
who's
Maria.
Watching and listening online, we greet you in the name of Jesus. And I want to pray for you right now because the Bible says we're one in the Spirit and we're one in the Lord. We're many members of the same body. So even though we may be separated physically, there is no distance in the Spirit, right? Okay, get ready, Z-Team. I'm going to pray for you too. Father, I thank you for our amazing Z-Team, and I ask you to just knit us together just in one spirit and one accord today so that we can minister to you and have a service that's pleasing for you. And we pray for everyone who's watching and listening that today they will receive something that will change their lives and make life better and improve their walk with God and the results that they get when they believe you for things and for changes and for blessings. And Father, we pray for salvation today and healing, deliverance, all manner of blessings in Jesus' name. Now listen, If at any time Amen. You receive a blessing or a miracle, and people do get miracles online, go ahead and write us right then. Send us a praise report. We want to be able to rejoice with you. Right, Pastor Loretta?
Amen. That's right, Pastor Larry. I know. No, actually, I was clicking myself on, clicking myself off, clicking myself on. But also,
well, that's
Pastor,
all right.
Yes, that I want to say this, Pastor, as you welcome Brenda. We're so excited to see Brenda online. And also Maria, I believe that's Anna's sister. So welcome for Anna, Anna Maria's sister, Maria Isabel, is joining us. So
hi, Maria.
We're excited that, yes, praise God.
Sí, bienvenidos, Maria. Welcome. Praise the Lord. I tell you, we love Javier and Ana Maria's family. It's such a wonderful family, and we have the privilege of being with Ana Maria's nephew and his wife tomorrow. They're here in Barcelona doing some work. Well, listen, I have a message that I believe is really going to resonate with everyone here. It's about faith confession. And you say, well, I've heard that. Well, I have too. I grew up in the faith movement, so to speak. I was there in the early days of Brother Hagin's ministry and watched it explode. I worked in the ministry and I was one of the early adopters. But let me tell you something. We need a refresher every now and then. I have to admit that I've developed some bad habits lately. And it just started off with me just kind of, doing things happy-go-lucky and not thinking about it. But then I started listening to what was coming out of my mouth, and I was making some very poor confessions. And I believe, I know you do too, that we're going to have what we say, either for good or bad. Remember, the Bible says life and death are in the power of the tongue. So every word that we speak is going to have an effect, either a positive effect or a negative effect. And so we're going to have a little refresher course. And I've got two things to point out to you that you may not have ever thought of before, but I believe it's going to help you. It's helped me. So once again, Father, thank you for the word of God. I pray that you'll allow me to stand in the office that you've called me into and to speak your word with clarity. And I pray for open hearts and open minds. In Jesus' name, let me hear an amen.
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 I'm going to remind you of something that happened in the life of Jesus. We read about it in Mark, in the 11th chapter, when he spoke to the fig tree. Remember the story? He was in Bethany and on his way to Jerusalem, and he saw a fig tree with no fruit, and he cursed it. He talked to the fig tree. And he said, no man eat fruit of thee henceforth and forever. And the next day that this fig tree was dead, and the disciples marveled. And that's when he gave them this wonderful lesson that I'm going to get to about saying to the mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and it will obey you. But it started with him talking to that fig tree. He wasn't talking about the fig tree. He wasn't praying to his father about the fig tree. He had a conversation with the fig tree. Have you ever had a conversation with a tree? I have. I lived in Tulsa, Oklahoma back in the 70s, and I had a Chinese elm tree in my front yard, and I really liked that tree. It produced a lot of shade, and it was a big, beautiful tree. And I was one of the only people in the whole neighborhood that had a tree, and I liked driving up and seeing my tree. Well, one day I had some friends come over after church for lunch, and my friend said to me, too bad about that Chinese elm tree. It's going to die, you know. Now, let me tell you something. He and I both work for the prophet of faith, Kenneth Hagin. So he's made a bad confession, right? He said, it's going to die. I said, what do you mean it's going to die? I kind of took it personally because I really love this elm tree. And he said, well, there's this thing called the Dutch elm disease that's gone through here. And it's this street, all this neighborhood was lined with elm trees. And he said, if you notice, yours is one of the last elm trees. He said, look at people's front yards and you'll see stumps where they were cut down because you have to cut them down before they fall down. And I said, really? And he said, yeah, you may as well cut it down now to keep it from, falling over on your car or your house. And I said, yeah. That bugged me. I thought about it. And I used to drive home and I'd look at my tree and be happy. And now I'm driving home and look at my tree and I think, stupid Dutch elm tree's going to die and fall on my house and my car. No, why do I have to have an elm tree that's going to die? And I really had a bad attitude about my elm tree. Now, one day I came home from work. It was in the fall of the year. And I noticed something strange. I didn't know what it was at first, but I pulled in the driveway and I noticed that there were leaves everywhere. All over the ground were leaves. And I looked up at the Dutch elm tree and leaves were falling out of the tree. It wasn't late enough in the season for there to be fall, you know, the changing of the leaves. But here were these leaves raining out of this tree and all over the ground. I mean, leaves are just fluttering down. And I thought, what is going on here? And I'm staring at this tree, and I couldn't believe what I saw. Something was moving and undulating, and there was something that I couldn't really see that was going on, but this tree was kind of breathing and moving. And I went up to get a closer look, and I couldn't believe what I was looking at. There were web worms all over my tree. I mean, there were tens of thousands of web worms, these little tiny worms that are about a quarter of an inch, small, I guess would be the right word. And they are devouring this tree. They love Dutch elm trees, and they defoliated the entire tree. They are killing this tree. Now, it's not Dutch elm disease, like my friend said, but it still, it attacked my tree. You know what? I'm going to make a confession right now. I let my guard down. I let my guard down about that tree. That tree was my responsibility. So anyway, I looked at those worms and the destruction that they were doing. And I thought, well, Cliff was right. You know, I got to chop this tree down before it falls on the house. And I went to bed that night and couldn't really sleep very well. And finally, I just sat up in bed and the Holy Spirit said to me, why are you letting your tree die? And I said, what? I'm not letting my tree die. And the Lord said, you're letting your tree die. I put man in the garden to dress the garden and keep the garden, and you're not exercising your dominion. That tree is your responsibility. I want you to go out there and apologize to your tree and speak life to it. And I said, what? And the Holy Spirit said, you heard me. Go apologize to that tree. Apologize to the tree. So I got dressed and I went outside and I looked around to make sure that nobody was watching me. And I went over and I didn't want to be obvious about it. So I kind of leaned up against the tree and I whispered over my shoulder. I said, tree, I'm sorry that I let the webworms devour you, and it's my fault. And I should have been more vigilant in taking authority. And by this time, I didn't care if anybody was watching me or not. I really got into it. And I started talking to this tree and prophesying to this tree and speaking life back in the tree. And I mean, I wasn't ashamed at that point. I was boldly declaring that that tree would live and not die. And sometimes you just know you have the victory. And I turned around and went to bed and I slept very well. Yeah. And I went to work and came home and I looked for webworms and I couldn't find a single webworm. They had totally disappeared overnight. There were no webworms left on that tree. The day before, it was just a biblical plague. Well, not really, but it was a plague. And then now, the next day, no webworms. They're gone. And the next day, I'm looking at this tree very carefully, see what's going to happen. The next day, there are new buds. Every little branch has new buds on it, and the tree grew leaves again. Wow, it had been completely exfoliated. It should have died, but the worms, I don't know what happened to them. They were just gone. I guess they died and sank into the ground, but the tree sprouted leaves again. And as long as I remained at that house, that tree was alive and healthy. Praise God. Have you ever spoken to a tree? Well, listen, that's what faith people do. They speak positive words of faith. And remember how you felt back in the good old days, in the early days, when you were declaring this and confessing that and prophesying over this and speaking to the water and speaking to the clouds and the sky, and things were happening. And then time goes on and, you know, we have a few faith failures and, you know, get a little lazy about it. And then one day you wake up and you think, man, I got to fix this. I need to get back to the basics. So that's where we're going with this today, is back to the basics. But I have two things to share with you that I believe will allow you to see things in a new way, and it'll help you with your confession. So let's get to Mark 11, 22 and 23. Jesus answered and said unto them, his disciples, you know, they asked him about the fig tree, and he said, have faith in God. Now, some translations, like Young's literal translation, say, have the faith of God, or have the God kind of faith. That's important. He said, verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Do you get that? You got to speak to the mountain. Amen. And whatever you say, if you believe what you say is going to come to pass, then you will have whatever you say. Not necessarily what you're wishing for, what you're hoping for, what you would rather happen, but specifically, if you believe what you say and don't doubt in your heart. Now, remember, this is Jesus talking, and he had just demonstrated the power of words by cursing that fig tree. He talked to the fig tree, and he believed that those words that he said would come to pass, and they came to pass, and he had what he said. And he's teaching his disciples, and he's teaching you and me how that we can speak to the mountains and the problems in our lives and command them to be removed. And in this illustration, cast into the sea. In other words, out of your life. There's no more mountain, it's gone. No more problem, it's gone. And it's because of the power of speech. Now, there's a couple of things that we have to think about here. And number one, he says, believe in your heart and not doubt. Sometimes people have a head faith. They have a mental assent. They're agreeing up here, but their heart's divided. And the word doubt means to be divided or to be having a variance within yourself. In other words, you've got to get it lined up. Your head and your heart have to agree that what you say is going to come to pass, and you have to believe it. It doesn't work if you're wishy-washy. It doesn't work if you're double-minded. It doesn't work if you're harboring thoughts of doubt. You and I must believe that what we say shall come to pass. Praise God.
Amen.
Eating potatoes, right? This is the kind of stuff we used to feed on every day, every day, every day. And I think it's high time that we have a refresher course. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, let me tell you what Jesus did not say. And this might help you locate yourself. He did not say, whosoever shall ask God to remove the mountain and ask God to cast it into the sea and shall not doubt God's ability to move the mountain, he shall, you know, have his mountain removed. So many people pray about the mountains in their lives. Now, we're using this figuratively for any problem, a financial problem, a marital problem, a health problem. We need to do what Jesus said, and he didn't say to pray about the mountain. He said to speak directly to the mountain. In fact, he didn't even say take the problem to God. He said, you address the problem yourself directly. This is the God kind of faith. God believes his word. God has faith in his word. When God says something, he is absolutely 100% confident that what he says is going to come to pass. God doesn't doubt anything. And let me tell you four things that God says about his word. Praise the Lord. Start right here. Psalms 138:2, it says, you, God, have magnified your word above your name. Think about that. The name of God, Elohim, El Shaddai, Adonai, right? You've placed a value on your word above your name. Now, that doesn't mean that he doesn't value his name or it doesn't have value. It's a great, great value. But what he's saying here is, I am emphasizing this. I'm emphasizing that my word is of paramount importance. So God values his word. Do you value your word? Okay. Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. This is God talking. It shall not returning to me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it. God has confidence when words are released from his mouth, they're going to go forth and accomplish what assignment he gave those words. Keep going. Matthew 24:35, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Psalm 138:2, for you have magnified your word above your name. Now, my question is, do we value our words as much as God values his words? Do we value our words as much as we should value our words? Does your word mean something to you? The words that come out of your mouth, are they important? Do they have value? Do they have substance? Do they have a purpose behind them? Do you have an expectation that the words that come out of your mouth are going to accomplish something? Let me ask you a question. What's the most important thing at a wedding? Is it the ring? Is it the communion? Are the unity candle, the procession, the music, the flowers, the dress? What's the most important thing at a wedding? Is it the preacher? No. All of those things are important. But the most important thing are the vows that the bride and groom speak. When they speak those words, they are binding. They are powerful. And they create a miracle union where two people become one flesh through the power of the words that they speak. It's important that the bride and groom speak the appropriate words about themselves and their marriage during the marriage ceremony. That's what's binding. That's what creates the covenant. That's where the agreement is. When they speak those words before God and many witnesses, those words go out there and they keep producing blessings in their lives year after year after year. When problems come up, no, they're not going to give into that because they have confessed a successful marriage, right?
Amen.
Well,
amen.
The words that we speak are important. Negative words are important, because they create bad things that we don't want, and that changes things. So they are important. They have an importance, negative, but importance. And positive words have an importance as well. So what is the God kind of faith? It's having faith in what you say. God has faith in what he says. And right here is a place where I'm going to lose a few people. But we're really not talking about having the faith in God to do it. We're having faith in the words that we speak to do it. Having confidence. Faith is confidence. It's assurance that these words are going to come to pass. So yes, we have faith in the word of God. But he's asking us to have faith in our own words. Believe our own words. And not doubt in our heart, but believe that our words are going to come to pass. Believe that our words are going to accomplish the thing whereunto they were sent. Rhetorical question. Do you really have faith in your words? I know you have faith in God. I have faith in God. But my question is, do you have faith in your words? Jesus said, don't doubt that your words are going to accomplish what they're sent to do. Don't doubt that your words are going to move the mountain.
This
Listen, when you have a problem, when you have a mountain, don't tell God about your problem. Tell your problem about your God. Praise the Lord.
Come on, amen.
Can you say that again? When there's
amen
a mountain in your life, don't go to God and tell God about the mountain. Tell the mountain about God. So many times when there's a problem, we go to God and start complaining. God, there's this problem in my life. I've got this elm tree, and there's an infestation of webworms, and it's going to die. And what are you going to do about my tree? Isn't it a wake-up call when he says, I'm not going to do anything about your tree. I've given you authority. I've given you my word. What are you going to do about it? I've given you dominion. I put you in the garden to dress it and to keep it and to replenish the world and subdue the world. You have
Hallelujah.
The ability.
Amen.
You have the power. Grow up, God. Stand up, and speak up. And your words will accomplish the thing whereunto they are sent. You need to have the God kind of faith. God has confidence in his words. You need to have confidence in your words. Now, let me
Amen.
Get back to faith. Do we have faith in God? Do we need faith in God? Yes. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Yes, faith. But here's where you put your faith. You put your faith in the word that says you have authority. You put your faith in the word that says God will back it up. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And then you start,
Amen.
And you start speaking those words with confidence. Praise the Lord. Now.
Amen.
I'm going to get through this very quickly. Let me give you what I think is a key, and you may or may not have ever thought about this, but I want you to think about it. I'm going to read a scripture to you. And it is in 1 Peter, New Testament, 4:11. If any man speak, now we're talking about speaking, right? And the power of words, and how do we have confidence in our words. And I know sometimes it's hard to have confidence in our own word because we know that sometimes we're wishy-washy and mamby-pamby, and we don't always say what we mean and mean what we say. And sometimes we break promises, and all that works against us. And we've been making some bad confessions, and we think, oh, my God, now I've got to fix this and turn it around and start making some good confessions. And it seems like a struggle to get that all fixed and going in the right direction, but I'm going to give you a shortcut. Praise God. You're going to thank me for this. Praise the Lord. It'll probably be a very big offering today because people are going to be so grateful. 1 Peter 4:11, if any man speak, that means man, woman, boy, or girl, let him speak as the oracles of God, oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God gives. God has given us the ability to prophesy. God has given us the ability to yield to the Holy Spirit. God has given us the ability to be the oracle of God. What is the oracle of God? The oracle of God is the vessel through whom God's word comes into this earth.
Amen.
The Bible was not written by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved upon by the Holy Ghost. In other words, they became the oracles of God. Isaiah was the oracle of God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Daniel was the oracle of God. Elijah was the oracle of God. Moses was the oracle of God. These men and women yielded themselves to the Holy Ghost, and God spoke through them. That's what prophecy is. It's God speaking through us. It's not us just making things up and saying things that sound right. It actually comes by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And when we yield our vessels to God, his ability, his words are spoken, his will is released. And here's what we need to do is not just yak at the mountain and tell the mountain what you think and give the mountain your 2 cents worth and make all these wild declarations that you may or may not really believe. But if you believe and you know you've really you've yielded yourself to the Holy Ghost and you begin to speak those inspired words of God, then you have confidence because it's no more you that's speaking, it's God speaking through you. Hallelujah. Amen. So what I'm saying to you, don't just talk to the mountain, prophesy to the mountain. Hallelujah. Get anointed by God. Worship God and get in his presence. Speak in tongues. Glorify him. Lift up your hands, heavy hands without wrath or doubting, and let God move through you. He has designed you to be his vessel. He's designed you to speak as the oracles. Praise God. That's why it's so important that every believer speak in tongues, because it shows that we're under the control and the influence of the Holy Ghost. It's not us speaking, it's the Holy Ghost. And we need to learn how to hook up our mouth with our heart, so when the Holy Ghost moves upon us and comes out of our mouth, it won't be the word of man. It won't be our idea, our opinion. It will be the word of God. Hallelujah. So we study to show ourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. Amen. Praise God. Say what you mean.
God.
Mean what you say. Speak as the oracles of God. Praise God. Hallelujah. And let me tell you something. You know when you're prophesying. I know when I'm prophesying. I know when I'm speaking by the Spirit. I know when it's just me, and I know when it's God moving through me. There's an anointing on it. There's a conviction on it. Praise God. Yeah. So when the Lord spoke to me about that elm tree and told me to go outside and speak to it, I got anointed. And I started prophesying to that elm tree. And then here's my experience. Those worms disappeared overnight. And the new growth came the next day. Praise God.
Praise
I believe
God.
That those worms were a mountain. There were a lot of worms. And they were moved. You say, where'd they go, brother? I really don't care. They're just gone. Out of my life, out of my yard, out of my tree. And new life came. ZChurch, that's what I want for you. Dear brother and sister who's listening to me right now, that's what I want for you. Moreover, that's what God wants for you. Praise God. You need to minister according to the ability that God gives you. And he's given you the ability to speak as the oracles of God. If we will practice this, if we'll practice speaking from the heart and not just from our heads, we'll begin to see results. And as you see results, then you'll become even bolder and even more confident. There's nothing that succeeds like success. After you have one victory, you can have another. Praise the Lord. And we go from faith to faith and glory to glory. The best time to get a miracle is right on the heels of a miracle. When God gives you a miracle, then start looking for another one. Start speaking another one. Start looking at another mountain. Don't just stop with one mountain. Get the whole mountain range. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Whatever is opposing you and hindering you, then you need to speak to that mountain. I had a neat little graphic here, but I don't know what happened to it. I had a picture of a mountain that was looking real stubborn. Use your imagination. If you got something out of that, I want you to unmute yourself and make some noise. Give the Lord a hand.
Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Here's the two takeaways I want you to get. Number one is having the faith of God is having faith in your words. God has faith in his words. You have faith in your words. That's being an imitator of God. That's doing things the God's way. Amen. God values his word. God expects something to happen. So that's the first takeaway. And the second takeaway is don't just talk to the tree, the mountain, the worms. Prophesy. Amen. Father, I thank you for everyone who's watching and listening. And I'm going to speak a word over ZChurch. You are prospering. You are growing. You're enjoying the best of everything. You're always the head, never the tail, always above and never beneath. Z Team, you're blessed going out and blessed coming in. God always rewards your faithfulness. You'll never do without. You'll always have more than enough for yourself, your family, more than enough to share, because you have placed a premium on God's kingdom and serving Him. And because of that, you will have 30, 60, and 100-fold blessing on everything you do in Jesus' name. Now, you that are watching and listening on YouTube and Facebook Live and wherever you may be receiving this right now, I prophesy to you the words that I have spoken to you today, yea, that I have prophesied to you today, will take root and will grow and bear fruit. You will see an increase in everything that you do as you apply this word, as you apply this truth. If you'll get back to watching what you say and putting a guard on your lips, and be careful that you don't let this truth slip, you're going to see results that blow your mind. And those results will be divine. I prophesy blessings over you. All of those who tune in to Facebook, to YouTube, to watch Z Church, to be a part of Z Church, you will receive a blessing. I have prophesied over myself that every time I stand up, someone is going to receive a blessing. Someone is going to have a miracle. And more than just one or two, more than just a few, someone means you.
Hallelujah.
Wherever you are, wherever you are, lift your hands up.
Praise God.
And say, thank God that I have the power to move mountains.
Thank God I have the power to move mountains.
My words mean something.
My words mean something.
Holy Spirit, help me to put a guard on my lips.
Help me to put a guard on my lips.
And not let this truth slip. All right, now we can give him a hand clap of praise and rejoice. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father.
Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. When we find ourselves in a place where we need correction, we get correction. You know, God corrects those whom He loves. He chastens those whom He loves. And He isn't chasing us by putting disease on us or breaking our legs. That's just wrong, wrong, wrong. God chastens us by correcting us, by showing us a better way. He's long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but everyone should come to a knowledge of the truth. He's always trying to steer us back into a place where we will bear fruit and our fruit will remain. And I accept correction. I admit that I kind of let my guard down. I wasn't totally negative, don't get me wrong, but it's those little foxes that spoil the vine. And I'm so grateful for the grace of God that He allowed me to be corrected so that I could do more, so I could be more pleasing and more in compliance with Him and His word. I'm going back to the basics. Praise the Lord. I'm going back to the fundamentals of this wonderful message we call the faith message, which is really the Jesus method. Have the faith of God. Have faith in God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I'm prophesying that Z Church is growing. Our Z Team is growing. More and more people coming to serve and to minister and to volunteer and to reach further and do more than ever before. I prophesy that this church is going viral. The Holy Ghost is taking us viral. And suddenly people will be talking about Z Church all over the world. I prophesy it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Yep. Don't talk to God about your problems. Talk to your problems about your God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. When it comes to, moving mountains, oftentimes We are faced by financial mountains. Debt is a mountain. Not having sufficiency, that's a problem. And God has a solution for that. It's called seed time and harvest. Now, if we don't do what he instructs us to do, then that's going to just make the problem bigger. The only way to deal with the problem is to be obedient to the word of God. And the word of God says, give, and it shall be given unto us, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto us. We reap what we sow. So when it comes to tithes and offerings, many of us do that faithfully, not seeing the results that we want. Are you tracking with me? Not tithing and not giving is a big problem. But oftentimes we find ourselves tithing faithfully and giving faithfully and still don't see the results that we want as soon as we want and as thorough as we want. Well, the answer was in the message today. We need to speak over our tithes and speak over our offerings. We need to give them an assignment. You ever hear that before? I have. We need to speak over our tithe and speak over our offerings. And today, I encourage you to be obedient, to return your tithe to God. I encourage you to step out in faith and plant a miracle seed. But I want to encourage you to speak over those tithes and to speak over that miracle seed, because words produce. Amen. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it, will eat the fruit thereof. Praise God. You plant a seed, you're going to get a return 30-fold, 60, right? 100-fold, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. Let's start with the tithe. After you return your tithe today, do it online, send a check, however you do it, I want you to say aloud, speaking to that gift, speaking to that dollar amount, and say, I have returned my tithe unto God. And I say that the windows of heaven are open above me, and financial abundance is pouring into my life without delay. Praise God. I added without delay because sometimes that's a challenge, right? I'm going to say it to you again. Over your tithe. Now, you can write your own confession. You can use this one. Here's the tithe. I'm returning it to God, and I say to my tithe, your assignment is to open the windows of heaven above me so that God can pour out a blessing in my life so abundant that there's not room to receive it. And I say that it happens without delay in Jesus' name. You see? Amen. Don't just put your tithe there and forget about it. You need to give it a direction. You're a child of God. You have authority. Speak to that tithe. Expect results. Expect the windows of heaven. Expect those words to produce. Same thing over your offering. You have an offering. You give it to God today. It's a miracle seed. It's a sacrifice. Okay, that's wonderful. Now you need to offer up the sacrifice of praise, and you need to prophesy over that gift. So yes, give the gift, but give the gift with an assignment upon that gift. Here's what I wrote down. I have planted my seed, and I say that it is multiplying and producing 30, 60, and 100-fold financial blessings in my life without delay. You want me to say it again so you can hear it again? I have planted my seed, and I say that it is multiplying and producing 30, 60, and 100-fold financial blessings in my life without delay. Three times. You know, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I have planted my seed, and I say that it is multiplying and producing 30, 60, and 100-fold financial blessings in my life without delay. It's working right now in Jesus' name. I want you to follow your heart and the instructions of God. Return your tithe to God today. If he has spoken to you about planting a miracle seed, and if you've got debt, I'm absolutely sure he is talking to you about planting a miracle seed. If you've got a financial challenge, I am positive that he's challenging you to give a special gift that directly addresses that situation. And then, applying what you've heard today, give that seed an assignment. Praise God. Use your authority in Jesus. Father, I thank you for everyone who's returning the tithe today. Give them holy boldness so that they can open their mouths and prophesy over that tithe, commanding the windows of heaven to be opened and blessings to come down without delay. And likewise, they that are giving a miracle seed today, I pray that you will anoint them with holy boldness to prophesy over the seed that they are giving today, that they're planting today, that it will produce 30, 60, 100-fold financial blessings without delay. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we have a short video we're going to play that will give you some instructions on how to return your tithe and give your offerings. And we want you to come right back after that. Don't go anywhere. And we're going to have a wonderful communion service. We're going to have live prayer. And we're going to move on into our afterglow. So let's play that tape, please, Javier.
Okay, now it's my privilege to celebrate together because communion is a celebration and it is a commemoration. We have this ability to move mountains, to throw our problems away, to speak to them with authority because we are God's child. We have a very intimate relationship with our God, with our Father. And this is due to what Jesus Christ did for us, because there was this season, this abyss that separated us from God. The relation was broken. And after Jesus Christ sacrificed in the cross, all was solved. Everything was solved in our relationship with our Father. Every sin was forgiven, not only our past sins, even our future sins. Amen. We may be right now. So we have this confidence that we are His child, His beloved child. And Jesus Christ, to make us remember me, the night He was going to be given and go to the cross, he had dinner with the apostles, the disciples, and he took the bread and he blessed it and broke it and said it was his body that was broken for us. So our body, our mind, our heart, our health, our financial issues, our relationship with other people, everything was fixed. Everything that was broken was fixed. So let's take the bread to celebrate that. And after eating, he took the cup. And he said it was the cup of the covenant. It represents the blood shed by him for us, so that we could be clean and be made the justice of God, new creatures, child of God. So let's celebrate it.
Praise God, there is power in the blood. Thank you, Javier, and bless you, everyone. Right now, that blood is speaking for you, prophesying for you in heaven, speaking better things than that of Abel. The blood of Jesus is saying, have mercy, have mercy, have mercy. Praise God. Well, Pastor Loretta, you and Terry have some prayer requests, right?
I believe so. Terry, do we have prayer requests?
And yes, we do.
Pastor, thank you so much for that powerful message. And you are so right. We do need to get back to the basics. You know, a pilot, every time a pilot gets ready to fly, even though he may have gone to school years before, it always does. He always or she always does a checklist. A good pilot will always do a checklist. And that's what you're telling us to do, just to have a checklist to make certain that we are saying what the Word of God has instructed us. Thank you, Pastor. Praise God. Terry?
Amen. Powerful message. Yes. Javier is requesting Anna Maria's for a nodule in Anna Maria's thyroid glands to be removed so that she can retain her thyroid gland.
To pray for Anna Maria. Well, why don't you pray, Terry, please?
I'm going to command that thyroid nodule to be gone in the name of Jesus. We speak to that thyroid nodule. We command you to be gone in the name of Jesus, that Amen. She will have a healthy thyroid. It will serve her well. And with long life, Father, we thank you. You will show her your salvation. Hallelujah. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Do we have
Praise
more God. Prayer request?
Yes. excuse me. Gail is requesting prayer for her grandson, Zeke, for recurring pain and high fever.
Okay. Chris, I ask you to pray, please. Did you hear the prayer request, sir?
Can you run that by me one more time?
Gail, well, we need to pray for her, too. But she's asking prayer for her grandson, Zeke, for recurring pain and high fever.
Recurring pain and high fever. Okay. Father, we thank you for your word. Everything is applied in your word. And we speak to that recurring fever and pain and command it in the name of Jesus to be dissolved and to obey the word of God. Our God is bigger than you are, pain and recurring fever. And we also speak to the ailment, to Gail's ailment. It's a persisting ailment, and you can't beat the word of God. You can't beat the word of God. So we command it to be gone in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
We have more prayer requests, Terry.
That's all, Pastor. Thank you.
Praise God. Well, I'm going to relinquish this, but I want to just encourage everyone. You know, in the story where Lazarus was dead 3 days, here's the thought that I take away from what you're saying, Pastor. If a dead man, 3 days dead, can respond, 4 days, that's right, 4 days dead, can respond to the voice of God, how much more you are living, how much more in your life will those things respond to your word as you speak the oracles of God? Again, if a man 4 days dead can hear the voice of God, something dead, 4 days dead, can hear the voice of God, how much more those dreams in your lives, those things that you've desired, those relationships you want restored, whatever it is, how much more will those mountains, those things in your life will respond to your voice? That's something to think about. And I'll say it one more time because it bears repeating. If a dead man, 4 days dead, in corruption, completely corruption, brain went to mush, can respond to the voice of Jesus. And that was what Jesus said. He said to let Lazarus come forth. He spoke as pastor spoke to the tree, tree be healed. Whatever it is, if whatever's in your life, let us take that message. Again, if someone 4 days dead can hear and respond, how much more in your lives?
Praise God. That's a good, good point, Pastor Loretta. Very good.
Okay, well, I would like to remind each and every one of you to go to zchurch.life and view our past services and read our blogs. All the Zoe group links can be found there on the website under Divine Connections. And if you're looking for a place to serve, send an email to info@zchurch.life. We would love to put you to work. Now let's go to Afterglow. Today, Chris is our host.
Yeah, Christine, right before we do that, Elder Bob has a video for us.
It's time to give him glory.
Hi, I'm Bob Peck. I'm an elder at Z Church. Recently, I started to have some pain in my hip, and it got bad fast. Within a couple of days, it was at the point that I was having a hard time sitting at the computer to do my work. It was even waking me up to where I couldn't sleep. I couldn't lay down or sit. I was in trouble. And I got smart enough, after only a couple of days of pain, to pray and seek God and ask what's going on. And he very quickly, promptly, brought back to mind the fact that about 8 or 10 years earlier, I had gone to the chiropractor who had told me that pain was caused by the sciatica nerve being pressed up against the hip bone and muscles getting out of place. So he gave me exercises to do to help get the muscles stretched and back in their proper place. And it fixed the pain so well that after 8 or 10 years, I had forgotten all about it, had quit doing the exercises, and didn't even remember what caused that pain. But God brought it back to mind. I started doing those exercises. And by the time our Z Church service rolled around on Saturday morning, 2 days later, I would say I was in about 80% less pain. I got better fast, but there was still some pain. But during our pre-service prayer, Terry, our prayer leader, prompted by the Holy Spirit, spoke the words, peace to nerves and to every nerve in the body. Now, I hadn't told Terry I had any pain. If I had, she wouldn't have thought to pray about nerves. But it proves that God knows. The Holy Spirit knows every nerve in our body and every issue in our life, and he has both the supernatural healing power to heal it and the wisdom to know what's at the root of our issues and what natural things it's incumbent upon us to do to address those things. And when Terry spoke that word, I received it. I said, thank you, Jesus, I received that. And from that service until now, I haven't had one pain again. I don't know how much of that was miracle healing power or the exercises that God reminded me to be doing, but I'm going to keep doing both. I'm going to keep believing God for healing power, and I'm going to keep doing every natural thing that he gives me wisdom and shows me to do. And we can all do that in all of the affairs of our life. Seek God's wisdom and his design and do things according to his design. And we can have prosperity and health and life and peace in every nerve of the body. And for that, I give him glory.
ZChurch.life.